All right. Hello, everybody, and welcome to this video. I'm one of your hosts here, Phil. I'm on the technical marketing team at Elgato and excited to talk to you today about Wave DX and how you can get the best quality out of your microphone. Joining me today is Brett. You want to introduce yourself?
Hi. So my name is Brett. I work as a technical video producer at Elgato. I make a lot of educational videos. And it's great to talk about tech and audio. And with Wave DX, there's a fair bit of that.
So Wave DX is pretty exciting for us because it is our first dynamic microphone. We've had the Wave 1, we've had the Wave 3, which are condenser microphones. They're fantastic with the Wavelink software. You guys kept asking for a dynamic microphone and an XLR microphone. And that is what Wave DX is. But okay, so yeah, let's dive right into what we're going to talk about today, and that is really how to get the best sound out of your Wave DX. So if you're watching this video, either you already have a Wave DX or you're considering getting one and are looking to make sure that you get the best sound, then we're going to go over a couple different things today. Positioning, software features, VSTs, you know, audio effects, and take you through kind of from the most important to not the least important, but you know, basically from what makes the biggest difference to what makes the smallest difference in that order. Brett, do you want to kick us off with positioning the microphone?
Sure. So if you've noticed from the view of both of us here that we have the microphone pretty close, and that's because with a dynamic mic, especially Wave DX, it benefits greatly from the proximity effect. The proximity effect essentially just is as you get closer to the microphone, it picks up more detail, more bass, etc., and you get better sound quality. So ideally, where am I at? 2 or 3 inches from the microphone right now. Another thing to bring up is that Wave DX has an integrated pop filter. So you can get really close, and it's going to do a really good job of rejecting any plosives like from your P's and B's and that sort of thing.
It's also a top address microphone. So as you'll see, we are both speaking into the top of the microphone, not the side. This is a common mistake that happens a lot that we see that people will talk into the microphone from maybe not the right position where the microphone is pointed in the wrong direction. Commonly, it happens more with side address microphones, actually like the Wave 1 and the Wave 3. Those are side address microphones. Wave DX is a top address, and so you just talk right into the top of it. That proximity effect that Brett was talking about is also one of the key differences between a condenser and a dynamic mic in that they both have this. However, it's very exaggerated on a dynamic microphone due to the properties of how a dynamic microphone works. So you're going to do yourself a lot of favors by just getting as close as you can basically to the microphone to the point where, you know, yeah, you're just talking right into it.
And actually, related to the proximity effect a little bit, is that a dynamic microphone is, at least in the streamer and creator space, is well known for its ability to reject room sound or room noise. And so it ties in with proximity effect a little bit. So if you're speaking into the microphone from 3 feet away, your viewers may not hear you because it rejects sound that isn't directly in front of the microphone so well. So it's like a built-in kind of noise reduction. You don't have to worry about what's going on as much as you would with, say, a condenser microphone.
It's also, that's another like common misconception that we've seen online is that dynamic microphones have a built-in noise reduction, which isn't the case. It's just simply, again, the properties of how a dynamic microphone works and that it's unpowered and that literally the power of your voice and the sound waves generate the electricity, which goes into the analog to digital converter. That's creating that sound. And because it's unpowered, it is much less sensitive to sound, unlike a condenser microphone, and so it just picks up less noise around you, but it does not have any sort of built-in noise suppression. But this does make it great for environments where you might have a little bit more background noise, or if you're podcasting and you have multiple people in a closer space together and you want to make sure that they're not kind of talking over each other and that everyone has their own audio feed. So, all right, we've covered positioning. Pretty simple. Keep it as close to you as possible. If you have something like a microphone arm, that is going to be perfect, especially one that's adjustable that you can just move very close to you. Next up is setting the correct gain. And gain is one of those things where, I mean, you pretty much can just find a sweet spot and leave it there. And with Wave DX, it is actually quite simple. gain among most audio interfaces is going to be pretty much the same. So our general recommendation when you're starting off with Wave DX is to set a gain of about 45 dB or decibels. If you have a Wave XLR, you can just set it to 45 dB in the settings there and Wavelink. Or if you have another XLR interface, maybe you have some dials or knobs on there that you can manually adjust, start off with 45 dB and then go from there. You know, speak into the microphone, see how it sounds, see if you're maybe too loud or too quiet. Generally, again, though, because of the way that these work, they're all going to be just about the same. So you shouldn't need to make any other adjustments there.
It depends on everyone's voices, everyone's comfortable distance speaking into the microphone. There's no one size fits all. Almost everything in this video is a recommendation. It's not a hard or fast rule. Besides speaking directly into the top. That's the one rule.
That is the one rule. But yeah, everything else is going to be a suggestion. So of course, your setup is different from mine. You can see I've got a couple wave panels actually behind me in my setup. Those are to make sure that my room, or at least my sound, doesn't sound as hollow because I don't have much furniture in this room. And you know, my microphone setup, because of that, is going to be a little bit different. Brett's here is also going to be a little bit different. So in the end, what we're doing here is trying to give you a great starting point so that if you weren't to not change anything, it would sound pretty great. And then you need to take it to the next, you know, add that little je ne sais quoi, that extra 10% on top of there to make it sound just perfect. So we've covered positioning the microphone. We've covered the gain level, or essentially the loudness of the microphone. Because Wave DX is an analog microphone, the microphone itself isn't going to do much else. So if you've got it in the right position, you've got the right gain, the microphone, that's pretty much it. That's all you can do. It's going to now pick up your voice. It's going to pick up background sounds, whatever. The rest of this is going to come down to the other products you use together with Wave DX. So we're going to move on to some more software-related features, some of them also hardware-related, specifically with the Wave XLR. To kick us off here, can we talk about low-cut filters a little bit?
Yeah, so a low-cut filter is designed to cut or remove frequencies below some threshold. With Wave XLR and other Wave products, the default is 80 hertz, so it's not an exact cutoff. It's a little bit complicated, but it sort of rolls off those lower frequencies. But essentially, it's going to reduce or remove those frequencies below 80 hertz. There is an additional 120 hertz low-cut filter called enhanced low-cut filter. And that's if you have an exceptional amount of rumbling or traffic or neighbors or something, you know, above you. The 120 hertz enhanced low-cut filter can help remove some of that. With other VSTs and audio effects, which we'll get to a little bit later, you can essentially make whatever low-cut filter you want. But it's a good idea to have some sort of low-cut filter added on to kind of as a almost like a pre-filter stage.
Those lower frequencies are not really well reproduced by most speakers, right? There's a reason that you guys would get a subwoofer if you have like a home theater system, because those can handle basically all frequencies under 80 hertz, or I think basically under 100 hertz, right? If you're wearing headphones or you've got laptop speakers or even just computer speakers, those generally can't handle those lower frequencies. So what they end up doing is they put strain on the headphone speaker or on the just on that dedicated desktop speaker, and that actually muddies the other sounds a little bit. So you'd be doing your viewers a favor by removing that lower end, because it actually frees up their speakers to focus on the frequencies that they can actually reproduce, you know, everything kind of like 150 hertz and up. You could still, you know, not use a low-cut filter, but it's generally a good recommendation at least to do the one at 80 hertz. If there's still a lot of rumble in the sound, then you might want to consider 120 hertz, but we would suggest starting with 80 hertz and just leaving that on in there. This is also specific to Wave XLR. Again, if you're using a different audio interface, it might have a low-cut filter built in. It might be something you have to turn on or off. It might be something that's, you know, a hardware setting. It might be a software-related setting. So definitely check that out on the audio interface that you're using. I think we're both using Wave XLRs here. So in that case, it's in Wavelink. You would just go into Wavelink, open the settings menu, and then you have an option there of off 80 hertz and 120 hertz. Very simple to set up. The other feature you get with Wave XLR together with Wave DX is ClipGuard. It's not gonna Well, it's another one of those settings that we just suggest keeping on. But Brett, what is ClipGuard and why would we suggest keeping it on?
Yeah, so ClipGuard is a pretty cool feature where inside of WaveXLR, there are sort of two signal paths. One is at the gain that you're setting it to, and then another is, I forget the number, but it's a lower gain level. And so anytime you get closer, you're about to hit the maximum signal, essentially, that it can handle, it switches over to that lower signal path. And the end result is you never clip. In the name ClipGuard, it is a safeguard from clipping. And if you have your gain set up properly and you have everything configured correctly, you should never really hit that, ideally, but it is there to protect you. And so there's really no reason to turn it off.
And yeah, we would just suggest keeping it on. It's, again, something that generally is going to be more effective on a condenser microphone that's got power running through it, where you can get a lot louder. With a dynamic microphone like Wave DX, you might not need it, but it also won't affect the signal. So you're not going to like degrade your audio just by leaving it on. And it's, again, that knife safeguard. So if you do get that win or that loss, no chicken dinner, and you get a little bit passionate, then ClipGuard will be there for you and protect your viewers' ears.
So it turns out that Phil and I really like to talk about microphones and audio. Who knew? So we spoke a little bit longer than we initially planned. In part two, we'll talk about VSTs and audio effects in Elgato Wavelink and how to use them with your Wave DX.